This is Michael Kowalski, writer and performer of Mothman, True Story, and you are listening to the Unbelievers Podcast. I know you wouldn't like it.
There were several groups. One of the principal ones was the reptilians from the Iran complex.
Without any exaggeration, it was like being on fire inside.
Rats were eating you up inside.
This stuff was in my mouth. It felt like it was 500 pounds. It was unbelievably hot.
My first question would be, were you a member of the Church of Satan, a card-carrying member of the Church of Satan?
I don't understand.
There's always an argument for no reason. Just because somebody can fake something doesn't necessarily.
We found a life form, and that's when I started shitting my pants.
So for the person who called, I am carrying an alien.
Covered right here, okay?
Okay.
Something is happening. What is it? That's the question. So do UFOs exist? It depends on what you mean, exist.
Celebrities, the most special people in the world. Unique and beautiful individuals who have worked tirelessly in the fields of music, film, and television to provide endless entertainment to us, the unwashed masses. But did you know that many of them have seen ghosts? Tonight, the Unbelievers Podcast returns to the spooky world of specters and floating lanterns to discuss four unbelievable cases of famous frights. Can the recently deceased contact our favorite film stars from beyond? Can a haunted television save your life? What is happening in Joan Rivers' ballroom? We'll find out now as we peer through the thin veil of the living and the dead and investigate the red carpet line back hallways of the star-studded A&E TV cavalcade. It's Celebrity Ghost Stories. Right here on the program, we continue to learn to unlearn everything you know. Hello and welcome to the Unbelievers Podcast. I'm your host, Rus Ryan, and joining me as always is my co-host, Drea Mora. Hello, Drea.
What up, Rus?
And my co-host, Jude Prestia. Hey, Jude.
Hello, everyone.
And our soundboard engineer and producer, Rob Okey.
Who eat potatoes trying to get into old pair of Levi's.
What's up, guys?
Oh. What's up, Rob?
Thanks, Rob.
What's up, Jude?
Yeah.
Yeah, Jude, welcome back. Been a little while. We've been having a nice little string of guest hosts. We had Aaron, K Mill, we got Jude in here. Great to have you back, buddy.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I love it.
It's a party.
It went from a revolving third seat on the Unbelievable Podcast to a revolving fourth seat on the Unbelievers Podcast, which is great.
Which is,
yeah,
good.
For real.
I would say the more the merrier. We've never really tried it with what I think the most we've had was like seven when we had like
It turns into like a gangbang. Like it's too crazy.
Nuts.
It's too much.
It's fun, but just like most parties, it gets crazy.
Well, there's four of us here tonight, and there's also four things we're gonna be talking about. So let's just get into it. Tonight's episode: Celebrity Ghost Stories.
Flipping this one final switch, I'm effectively ensuring that I will be overcoming all resistance long. My remains have been vaporized with extreme prejudice and shot into outer space. I'll be haunting you.
Yeah. They Might Be Giants. I always get called out when I can play They Might Be Giants and I don't. So there you go. I'll be haunting you. They Might Be
Perfect.
Giants. Because tonight, we will be discussing a few ghost stories, but these aren't your everyday, regular people ghost stories. These are celebrity ghost stories. You guys love celebrities, right?
Yes, they're heaven
sent.
They're
better
than
us.
Love them. They're so much better than us. This is why their stories are going to be better than our stories.
Who does it? They're the best. And these stories, they all come from an A&E channel program called Celebrity Ghost Stories. This show ran
Whoa.
From 2009 to 2014. It was brought back earlier this year for a sixth season. And I have
Jeez.
To say, a lot of celebrities have ghost stories. Almost all of them. The lineup of these episodes is star-studded.
I've seen a couple episodes of this. That's an interesting choice of words, but it's true. There are some stars.
Oh, there's a lot. Every celebrity has seen a ghost. So let's just get into our first celebrity ghost story now from none other than Regis Philbin.
Yeah.
you all know Regis. Oh, Regis, we love and Kathy Regis. Lee fame, and Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Yes.
He's been on television for decades. He's a real icon. But did you know that he has had ghostly experiences?
Uh-uh. No, did not know that.
Now you do. Let's hear it.
When I was starting out in television, I finally got my own talk show, which is something I always wanted to do. So I wanted things that weren't being done on television. So one day, we had a famous ghost hunter on the show. His name was Hans Holzer. As a matter of fact, he was from New York City. He came as a guest on the show because he had written a book on it, and I was curious about it myself, and so got into a nice conversation with him. And then, during the commercial break, I said to Hans, you know, there is such a thing as a haunted house here in San Diego.
Well, right off the bat, Hans Holzer... Hans Holzer, that he's a huge pioneer in the world of parapsychology. And I think at this time, this was in the 60s, when his book, The Ghost Hunter, was published. So this is likely around like 1963, 1964. This guy is a real like pioneer. He wrote like 120 books. He was the first to investigate the Amityville horror.
Okay.
Wow. What's his name again?
Hans Holzer. He's very, very famous. Yeah, for Amityville horror, lots of stuff. And Regis does seem to be in the weird stuff. He says, I finally got a show, and I get on, I want to have these people on, and Regis knows about a haunted house.
One does exist. Hey, Hans. One does exist, yes.
I know a haunted house in San Diego.
He was a little more muted than he was. Hans, you'll never believe it. There was this house. It was so haunted. You got to come with me. Bring your friend.
There actually does exist a haunted house in San Diego.
There's several.
Yeah, yeah, who knew? He was like a 60s unbeliever. So let's hear about Regis in this haunted house.
Now, the house was called the Whaley House. It had been built in the 1800s in San Diego. There was an Anna Whaley who kind of started that house many years ago. He said, the next time I'm in town, I'd love to go over there. I said, fine, we'll go together. So stayed in touch with him via the telephone, and sure enough, about, I don't know, 6-7 months later, he was coming back onto the West Coast. He would come down to San Diego, and he would love to go to this house. But this time, because he knew we were going to the Whaley House, he brought with him a witch, a legitimate witch from England named Sybil Leek.
That is another, in this story, there's another huge name in the paranormal, Sybil Leek. She is a famous witch, psychic, astrologer, occult author, and the BBC crowned her Britain's most famous witch, a white witch.
Oh, okay. Cool. I guess that's the thing. I've never heard of her.
I can't.
But what
she's
do I know?
Very acclaimed in England.
In England. And okay.
Regis got Hans Holzer. He's got Sybil Leek. He's got
these
this
names,
whole.
I'm sorry. You got a hand holder.
It makes me feel like I don't know anything. I don't know any of these
Leaking people. I've never heard of this.
If we would have been around in that time, yeah, these were the big names of then. But I mean, these people have all passed on.
Okay.
No, yeah. These are
the Stephen Greers of their day.
Yes, yeah. They definitely were.
All oiled up and greasy.
I think Hans might have been more of the Zach Baggins, and Sybil Leek was that, I don't know, weird lady that he found in his basement.
Oh, yeah. The snake. Lady Snake?
Snake, I think, was her name. I'm pretty sure you're right about that.
There you go. She's the good version of that, whatever her was. But so now Regis Philbin, Hans Holzer, and famous witch Sybil Leek, they meet up in San Diego to visit the haunted Whaley House.
So anyway, the name was Sybil Leek of this witch, and the Sybil was telling us first she had to go into a trance. He would put her in the chair, he hypnotized her, and he would put her under. And then he would ask her questions about what was she sensing. Are you feeling anybody else's presence here? And she, yes, in particular, I feel a woman's presence. Yes, there is a woman here. Is she happy still being here? No, she doesn't want to leave. And what's her name? Her name is Anna. Anna Whaley, the woman who had lived there first.
Regis is pretty good at telling ghost stories. It's like, yeah, it's like a campfire thing.
He's good at talking.
I can see why he would have a talk show.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's literally spent the last like 70 years talking into a microphone, so he's good at it. For
Did
sure.
you guys
no,
know?
I always imagine him way up here. He's got to be super excited. He can bring it down when he needs to.
And he can get scared.
He can. He can scare us because this witch, Sybil, this witch also told him that not only is the ghost of Anna Whaley present there, that the husband that lived there is also there. And you can sometimes when his ghost is present, cigar smoke is his ghost trick. And you smell cigar smoke and you know that's him. So let's get another clip. Here's more about the story of Anna Whaley.
Anna's daughter did commit suicide in the house. And that was one of the things that I guess haunted Anna at the time. And maybe that's why she didn't want to leave the house even when she passed. Hans Holter thought that was a big victory because it kind of proved to him that, yes, indeed, there's a ghost here. And got me interested as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, there you have it.
Anyway, we had a wonderful show. I filmed the piece with Sybil Leek and used it on the show, and it got tremendous reaction. Well, I think everybody's fascinated by the expression haunted houses.
I would have loved to have seen that. A young, spry Regis running around with a witch and a
even
famous
more energy.
Ghost hunter.
Just yelling at everything, screaming at everything.
Well, this is the lost media I want to see. This is some lost media. The old Regis show with a witch. That's some classic stuff. I wonder if there's any footage out there.
Well, you didn't find any.
It sounds like it was a successful segment.
The people loved it. And they went there.
I don't know. Am I missing something? This doesn't seem like he witnessed it. This doesn't sound like a ghost story.
He saw a witch.
He saw a witch.
This is just the
feel
beginning.
Okay. Okay.
Hold on. A witch told him some things. And they filmed a special. But after the special airs, a Marine colonel friend of Regis asked him if they could go stay at that Whaley house together, alone.
Ooh.
His Marine friend, he didn't believe in ghosts, and he wanted to see for himself.
So he, who didn't believe at the beginning, said, "This is ridiculous. You're wasting a lot of time here. There's nobody here. There's nothing here." And I said, "No, let's just wait a little while longer.
Just give it a little time."
And I proceeded to walk around the floors and go upstairs and just peek around, make sure everything was in order. Came back to the living room, and I had the flashlight. And there we sat in darkness. So the hours went by, and it must have been 2:00 in the morning, and by this time we're plunged in darkness. And of course, my friend, the tough Marine, was heckling me about how silly this is, what a waste of time it is. And then suddenly he stopped talking. He says, "Don't turn on the light." I looked up and looked through the archway. And there was this image illuminated in white. It was almost like a transparent shape of a woman, really. Not going down all the way to the floor, just standing there.
Yeah, there it is, Drea. He did
there
see
it is.
Took his Marine friend. Just two guys hanging out in a dark haunted house together.
As you
weird
do.
Going on.
Don't turn on the light.
Don't do it.
Yeah, no. Oh, wait. The Marine doesn't talk like him, does he?
Oh, that's right.
I forgot.
But he was
totally
really
picturing
good.
That they're both going to talk like creatures.
I'm a Marine.
We finally did get the place on board one. We finally did get the great upspeak Regis. A little taste of it.
There's nobody here. There's nothing here.
But no, yeah, those key details. Well, one, like I said, like you said, he's very good at storytelling because I was like in suspense. He's really good at it. But the fact that he had to even mention that it didn't go all the way to the floor, that's something that stood out to him that he remembered. And that is something that really that happens often with apparitions that people see.
Yeah, to give an image, these guys are just sitting on the couch together, and Regis said he's got the flashlight, so he's in control of all light, and this thing appears in front of them. So they are both, the Marine and him, they are both seeing something strange. Let's see how tough that Marine acts.
I knew this tough old Marine had seen it too. Now, he got on his hands and knees, and he began crawling like he was approaching the enemy. And he quietly pulled his way over the floor to the end of the room. And I got very, very, very excited because, honestly, I thought somebody or something was there. And I knew what he was going to do. He's a Marine. He's going to go and tackle it. Bring it down. I was just beside myself.
And the visual of this is so funny. Imagine like a little plastic army man crawling across the floor to a ghost. That's what his friend is doing. It's so funny.
I know. That's the thing you least expect.
Regis is just sitting there watching him do this the whole time, too, which is even funnier because you would imagine like maybe like follow him or something. But he's just sitting there watching this man crawl towards a ghost.
Yeah. And the best part is like he's not even scared while watching. He's like excited, like, oh, he's going to tackle the ghost. He's going to be tackle it. He's going to get him. I can't believe it.
It's awesome. So this guy, this Marine, he is slowly crawling to the specter. Like, he's in the trenches, in total darkness, with Regis. And here's what happens.
So he got as close as he could. I couldn't stand it anymore. I held the light out there and flipped on the flashlight. And there was nothing there. The colonel was very upset. I didn't follow his orders, not turning on the light. I went through all of that, took a good look against the wall. And there was a picture of a woman. The image was right smack up against the picture on that wall. And it was Anna Whaley. And that is precisely the person that our friend Sybil Leek had picked up in her seance, who is still interested in continuing her afterlife there. The connection between the picture and that image meant something.
Huh.
All right, Reed just blew it. So I'm trying to explain it. He blew it. He wimped out.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if it was wimping out because he couldn't stand it anymore. He wanted to see what it was. It didn't sound like he was scared during any part of this.
No, but he should have let the colonel jump. Ambush the image, the apparition.
What would have happened if the Marine tackled the ghost of Anna Whaley, you know, and taken her prisoner?
He
what was he going to do from there?
Dude, yeah, like, kicked her ass. She would never stood a chance. Poor Anna, man.
That would have been like Mortal Conflict.
Conflict.
Mortal Conflict.
Wait, so I got confused for a second, though. It almost sounded as though he's like, oh, I turned on the lights and there was a portrait. Instead, like, maybe they were just seeing
Dude, that's exactly what I heard. That's why I was like, my face contorted. I was like, what the hell? Is he just saying he's just looking at
some kind of light reflecting? Yeah, was something reflecting that portrait and making the exact luminescence of it in front of it, and that's what he's seeing.
Doesn't line up, though. That doesn't line up.
If you were a ghost, would you go and stand in front of a picture of yourself and be like, that's me?
Hey, I was looking pretty good back then. Yeah, you check yourself out. It's like a mirror.
Yeah, maybe.
Ghost mirror.
We don't know how these things work. That's a possibility.
That's true. We don't really know shit.
Yeah. Well, this one's about to wrap up, so let's see if Regis can explain his actions.
We turned off the flashlight, and the colonel came back and sat on the other end of the couch. And we both looked intently, and we waited and waited, and the ghost never came back. We never, ever saw that illumination again. But I'm telling you, that night, I saw a ghost. I know I shouldn't have turned on the light. I'm sorry. I got carried away. And to this day, it kind of haunts me. Spirits, they'll give you so much, but they're not going to go all the way with it, you know. Anna Whaley is still here, still in this house. She came down that night to visit us and to tell my friend, yeah, there are such things as ghosts.
Okay, I believe him.
Yeah, that was. I accept this apology also.
Yes.
I like that Anna Whaley is not willing to go all the way. So she's staying true to herself.
Ghosts don't go all the way. It's like, Dan Aykroyd would be different.
Yeah, way. I was like, much to Zach Bagans' disappointment, but I think they just won't go all the way with him.
Hans Holder said she'd go all the way. My friend tried to tackle her, so he ruined it.
I find this interesting. I've been to the Whaley House in San Diego.
Really?
Yeah, I have. It's really neat. And the thing is, I never felt any kind of like fear or like any like unease. In fact, if anything, I felt really like I liked it a lot. Like I felt really comforted. Especially there's this part where you're looking into the like living room and kind of like den area where people would just, I guess, hang out and spend their time. And I just felt such a compulsion to stay there. Like, it just felt really like inviting.
And him and his friends seemed like they were drawn to it. And they wanted to sit on that couch real close to each other in a big house by themselves.
Really close to each
other. Maybe she liked you and you were just feeling that energy that she was welcoming you. She was welcoming you there, you know?
Yeah. I'm curious. I'm going to go check it out again at some point. If it's open, I'm not sure. But when I do, I'm going to see if it's, you know, the same.
I can't believe Drea was in that room.
Yeah.
I believe Drea was in the room where that guy crawled across the floor.
She's no Marine. She's no threat. She's cool. I'm not going to mess with her.
Yeah, I'm just gonna give her a beer or something. Let's hang out, Anna.
I wish more ghost hunters would use this technique of tackling ghosts. I've never really heard of this one before, but imagine if Zach Baggins just flew around tackling ghosts. That'd be awesome.
I want to see him crawling around in his own house doing stuff like that. It'd be amazing. But we're going to move on now. That's enough of the Regis. We're going to move to another celebrity, Joan Rivers. Are you guys fans of Joan Rivers?
Oh, huge.
She's a legend.
So much.
She truly is.
Truly is. Long history, comedy, television, and Joan Rivers tells the story of how she reached a low point in her career. Her husband had committed suicide, her talk show got canceled, and she had bad investments. So not a lot going on for Joan. So she took what money she had left, and she left Los Angeles to move to New York and moved into an old ballroom apartment that was in disrepair. And as this place is getting fixed up, she stops by to see the progress, and then this happens.
Labor Day weekend, on the way home, I had my dog in the car, and I thought, I'm going to go and just take a look at the apartment, because that was really, like, going to be my new home. And my dog, which is a little Yorkie, who always ran into the apartment, had a wonderful time. We got to the door that night, and he wouldn't go in. Absolutely would not go in the apartment.
Jordan, what's the matter?
I went in the apartment, and it was a very hot August night, and
tonight.
It was freezing cold. The apartment was very, very cold, and there were pornographic writings and markings on the walls. It was just very strange, and the dog was barking and carrying on at the door.
Yes. So Joan Rivers goes to see the progress in her apartment. There are pornographic, weird images drawn on the wall. The dog won't go in. It's cold. What's going on?
I was wondering if I heard that right.
Yeah, I was like, she couldn't have said pornographic.
She did.
Pornographic writing. I've never even. Is that like.
Yeah.
This show is on
clearly, you've never read Penthouse.
In the recreation, there's just these crude drawings that are like mildly sexual, but this is on TV, so it wasn't
just dick and balls all over the place.
Yeah.
And then we kind of have all realized that she said it was a very hot August night, much like tonight. So y'all check your walls, make sure there's no pornographic writings on them, and we'll be
sure the dog wants to come in.
Yeah.
If it's cold, something's going on, but the story's going to go on. So here is more Joan Rivers.
I just didn't know what the hell happened. So I get back into the elevator, and I say to the elevator man, gee, my apartment's so cold and the dog won't go in, and it looks like somebody was in there writing on the walls. And he said to me, oh, I guess Mrs. Spencer is back. And I said, what are you talking about? Mrs. Spencer was a niece of J.P. Morgan, the financier. Originally, it was all her house, and she lived here all her life, and as she got older, she kept moving further and further upstairs, and she would rent out the lower floors, and she ended up living in the ballroom, and she died there 7.5 years ago in the ballroom. And she comes back and she just does things to people in the house.
Yeah, like porn.
Miss Spencer.
This is Mrs. Spencer. She's a relative of J.P. Morgan. That's pretty weird,
yeah.
Huh, dude?
Yeah.
So, Joan Rivers is a...
I was going to say something about the Titanic, and I was like, you know what?
Because
you know he brought that thing down, yeah.
So, yeah, this woman lives in... now, Joan Rivers is getting this top... It's a weird to hear a ballroom and apartment.
The ballroom's upstairs, too? Is that...
Yeah, it's like
New York City is weird sometimes. The buildings are a little strange, and like they'll do that where they'll put like a ballroom on the top floor, and then it depends on who owns the building. Sometimes it'll be like where they'll do parties and that kind of stuff, and
like
they use
penthouse?
The top floor. Yeah, it's that's what they use the penthouse for technically. But also in New York City, you know, it's tough to find apartments, so I'm sure they converted it to some sort of a studio living situation.
That makes sense. Okay, so it was a ballroom converted into an apartment.
Yes.
Well, this is Joan River, so it's pretty nice.
It's probably pretty
very nice. Yeah. Very nice.
I wish I could have
seen
it.
It's a really cool place. But the strangeness continues in this ballroom, whatever, apartment. It's always cold. Her dog is freaking out. There's lots of strange activity, which leads to Joan Rivers having to take action.
I don't know what the hell to do. I'm a widow. I put all my money into this apartment. You want your home to be your haven. You don't want to not want to put out your lights at night. So I called up the New York University, the parapsychology department, and I said, they say my apartment, my house is haunted. Will someone come and help me? And she said, oh, we don't do that. And I said, you cannot leave me like this. The fear was suddenly about a whole new thing. It wasn't about my husband's suicide, and it wasn't about that I was out of work, and it wasn't about that I had no money, and where was my next job coming from? What I was focusing on was something totally different. I said, you cannot leave me like this. And she said, we shouldn't tell you this, but in New Orleans, there is this woman, she is a voodoo priestess, and maybe she can help you.
So we got a voodoo priestess. First you got Regis and a witch. Now you got Joan Rivers and a voodoo priestess. And Jude, you heard that NYU parapsychology. That's what
she
Ghostbusters
literally
were.
Called the Ghostbusters.
It's like a movie. It feels like a movie.
I know. I love it. I wish somebody would make a movie out of this. This sounds awesome. And such a huge jump to go from Ghostbusters to a voodoo priestess.
It kind of reminds me of Skeleton Key. Have you guys ever heard of the movie Skeleton Key?
No, but I want to.
Sounds familiar.
It's kind of a little bit similar story to this, but not exactly.
Well, I'm into it.
It's also like Ghostbusters.
Ghostbusters.
I wonder how many calls NYU parapsychology gets all the time, just being like, yeah, is Venkman work there? And they hang up.
I'm curious to see if they go like busting all over Joan Rivers' walls.
And you know Ray had to be the one to suggest a voodoo priestess. We're all kind
true.
Of with that.
True.
So Miss Rivers, yeah, Joan Rivers, she calls this voodoo priestess in tears and she tells her all about her situation. So the voodoo priestess comes to New York. Check it.
I went to the apartment with the voodoo priestess and she conducted a ceremony. The ceremony was like something out of a bad movie, chanting and talking and drumming. And she said to me, Mrs. Spencer was very angry. She was still, in her mind, the grand dame of the building and did not like what was being done with the house. It's my home, and it's my building, and who are these people? And we put cornmeal all over the floors. It was so scary. And after about an hour and a half, she went... Ah! She went, it's gone.
Man, it's like an audition. I'm sure that voodoo priestess, she had to kind of know who Joan Rivers was. If you get that call, you're going up there to do
oh,
it,
hell
right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, true. I didn't really think about that. But yeah, you're going to want to impress.
Bring all your cornmeal.
Yeah.
I don't know about you guys. At the end there, I got big... Play soundboard too, because I got big Theodore vibes from that voodoo priestess kind of fixing it. Check this out.
It's gone.
Yeah, I don't know. They're somewhere in the same range there. It's something.
Hello. Theodore, don't.
I thought it was going to be the clip where I guess something's happening in the background, the dramatization, when she's like, and she went, and there was like this weird background noise, but it's not that.
They do that on this show a lot where they're like, and then the person said, and then they'll like stop for a second and they're like, actually, no, they said, no, there's nothing there. Like, they pull these, like, bait and switches all the time.
Overlapping.
Yeah, they line up the audio of the story with the reenactment. And the reenactments, I will say, they always try to get some kind of lookalike of all celebrities. So, like, a Joan Rivers lookalike. And they always kind of have that Vaseline-y faded look on the camera. So you don't look too hard. Like, this isn't Joan Rivers in this. So don't. You know.
No, I think this is great, though, what happened. She even said it was, like, a bad movie. So I don't think that she passed the audition, the priestess.
Oh, I don't know. We're going to find out, because immediately after this happens, Joan's apartment starts to warm up. The dog calms down. And so Joan and the voodoo lady, they come up with a new plan.
Let's go to the other apartments and see if they want help. 2:30 in the morning, we started ringing the bells in the apartments. Can you imagine? And we'd say, hello, I'm Joan Rivers. I'm cleaning up my apartment because Mrs. Spencer... was in my apartment. This is my friend from New Orleans. She will clean out yours if you like it. Not one person slammed the door. Everyone had a story.
Oh, shit.
Man, I would not turn down Joan Rivers and a voodoo priestess. I don't care what time it is.
Even 2:30 in the morning.
Yeah, right? I mean, like, hello, even Joan if Rivers. I didn't have anything going on, wouldn't you guys just pretend like you did have something going on? Like, oh, yeah, sure, come in.
Oh,
please.
It's so cold. Yeah. Here. I'm turning down the thermostat.
Woof, woof. I don't have a dog. But
he's scared.
He's scared. Do something, Joan. I mean, priestess. That's something... Yeah, you're not going to pass that up. Who's going to slam
a door?
That's a story.
Yeah, you have that forever. That great story. You know what? One night, Joan Rivers it might have even been a dream. It was late. I'm pretty sure it happened.
3 a.m, Joan Rivers and a voodoo priestess knocked on my door.
It doesn't sound like it could be true. It does not sound like it could be true,
totally
but it's very true.
Why would she lie about something like that?
That's what I mean.
That's the best part. It's not like I invented this story. It's like Joan Rivers is telling you the story of when she was knocking on people's doors.
It sounds like a Mad Lib. Like, it sounds like if it was like, insert a celebrity's name here. Now insert random
occupation.
Random occupation is like Joan Rivers and a voodoo priestess, of course.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to make a comic book about this. I'll pitch it to somebody. This is great. This is good content.
It is. And this whole door-to-door Joan Rivers voodoo cleansing sessions, they went on.
Everybody had a story, and she went and she cleaned out the entire house. Everything was fine, and the apartment was clean. I moved in, and then things started again. The dog was unhappy, the apartment was cold. I could never get any of my electrical things to work correctly. She came back, Mrs. Spencer returned.
No refunds. Yeah, so it doesn't seem like the voodoo... It's kind of a bummer, but the voodoo thing didn't work. And boy, it has to be embarrassing for the neighbors when you're so proud to bring your voodoo lady and then everything just comes immediately back.
Oh, dude, I mean, that's just... it doesn't look good when you've got a name like Joan Rivers and you have to go and
she's
tell your friends and family.
She's already at a low point. Now that even right? the public is going, she's lying
she's like,
about
Joan
voodoo.
Rivers can't even clean my apartment with a voodoo priestess. What else has she got going for her? That's so sad.
It's one tough ghost. Yeah. This ghost is resilient. Does not want to go anywhere. She's literally breaking out the big guns. And this ghost
Morgan.
Is just like, I'm not leaving.
Yeah. That's the scariest anywhere. Thing is when they come back, because then they come back pissed.
Well, this is when the real big guns come in, because Joan Rivers is now so desperate to be rid of this, she decides to confront the spirit herself, Baggins style.
Oh, shit.
And I said, Mrs. Spencer, I started to cry. I said, I am a widow. All my money's in this apartment. You cannot do this to me. You cannot do this to me. You must leave me in peace. And one night, I was down in the basement, and I was down there working with the handyman, and I came across this portrait of this lady, this woman, shoved behind drywall and broken bricks, and I took it out, and I knew the minute I took it out, it had to be her. I just knew it was her. It was very grand, very grand woman. And our old night doorman said, oh, that's Mrs. Spencer.
Yeah, it's hard to imagine Joan Rivers in a basement messing around with drywall with the handyman. But she found the portrait. She found the portrait of the woman. Man, portraits are a big thing. The portrait was a ghost mirror in the first story. There's a portrait
True.
Here, too.
Oh, man. There is that connection.
You're so right, too, about her working with this hand. She says, I was working in the basement with the handyman.
That was the most unbelievable part.
You were working in the basement. Joan.
Taking buckets of shit
out
of the
actress.
Basement.
You're a comedian actress. You're very old at this point. You're in your 60s or 70s, I'm guessing. And what are you doing messing with the boiler? Let's leave
all
the
right,
guy
let's
alone.
Stop. We need to work on the drywall. We have to get behind this dryer. We have to fix the boiler.
Just put in sheetrock.
I wonder what how was she dressed during this? I'm trying to imagine her in like, you know, some dirty jeans and sneakers, but
it's hard to imagine that. Like,
no.
So you would just
never,
think of her
ever.
Fully decked out
no,
in like
yeah, no, she's
neon,
green
a neon outfit. Yeah, like completely flashing it.
Oh, yeah.
And
well,
she's
good.
Judging the she's judging the handyman's outfit. She's like, what are you wearing? That's the Joan Rivers we picture. So, but there's more about this found portrait. So tell us, Joan Rivers.
I took the portrait, I cleaned it up, and I hung it in the lobby of our building. And the voodoo priestess called me and she said, I've had a visit from Mrs. Spencer. Oh. And she said, She's very pleased that you have put her back into her home, and she's very happy with what you've done to the ballroom, and she likes that you keep flowers there, so will you please always keep flowers in the ballroom? So, it has been 18 years, and Mrs. Spencer has gotten her flowers and her portrait.
Yeah, never underestimate the power of voodoo in Joan Rivers.
I think that's really good.
It was a genius move on her part to be like, clean up the portrait, make it prominent, and make it the home hers.
Yeah.
But what the hell was that sound in the background? Did you guys hear that?
Yeah, that...
It was like a cat screaming.
It's just that that quintessential horror movie sound.
It's an annoying part of the Unsolved Mystery song. That's just played over and over. I think it's for effect. Yeah.
No, I think she was spot on. That's just... It's kind of instinctive, right? You realize that that is... the same thing as it's what you have left these in the world is this picture of you.
Mm-hmm.
I just love all these old portraits. What are we gonna like? What are Argos gonna be in? Like, I'll post myself.
It's gonna be
like,
a Facebook profile picture. Happen?
My driver's license.
Yeah, it'll be your Snapchat. Like, I don't have Snapchat. I don't know how that works.
Yeah, can Instagram get haunted? I don't know how that works.
Yeah, I mean, we're gonna find out in the next decade or so. You know, but I think that's really good. I like how this ended up, you know? Like,
it was
like,
a happy ending.
Movie. Yeah.
It's a happy ending, but if good you thought movie. That was a happy ending, it actually even gets better.
What?
And she comes to visit me now. Just about every night. It's usually about 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. My dogs will wake me up. And you just feel this presence. And she will come through my bedroom. I'll say, hello, Mrs. Spencer. It's comforting, more than friendly, protective. It's a comfort. It's like she's checking on me. We're friends, and I know that Mrs. Spencer, look at this. I get very emotional about her now. I know she's there, and she's there to help me. My whole life turned in that apartment, and turned in a wonderful way. And it gave me a real home and a real sense of belonging. And I think what I did for her is I restored her home. So we both gave each other something that we both love. How nice to know I have Mrs. Spencer to say good evening to every night.
Yeah, it's very touching.
Aww. But so sweet.
I would really be annoyed to wake up at 3 o'clock every night, though. It's like, settle down, Mrs. Spencer.
You know why? Because she's coming into your apartment every night. She's like, check out this cock and balls that I drew. She's still decorating your walls with pornographic images.
Yeah, what about all that?
Yeah, I think that was just vandalism.
What? I know, right? This is just an open ballroom in New York City. Rob's probably going apartment to apartment and spread that stuff everywhere. I wouldn't blame Mrs.
Yeah,
Spencer
they never
that.
Made any connection between her and pornography. Or
she was super obsessed with porn, much like all of JP Morgan's.
It definitely, it leads you to think that maybe there was something more going on. Like, that sounds like demonic activity to me. Like, pornographic stuff written on
really?
A wall. I don't know. That doesn't sound like a ghost. Like, what kind of ghost just writes pornographic and draws, like, tits on your wall?
Yeah,
come on, dude.
It's like a whole other level.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. That seems like a very human thing to do.
You think
maybe
it's a human?
She got tricked by the voodoo lady.
Yeah.
Maybe. I guess. Yeah, you're right.
Like, dang. If pornography is a demonic activity, I think we're all pretty guilty of being demons.
Listen, I'm just saying writing it on the wall is a little...
that's a little, no-no. You don't draw it on the wall.
That's a little no-no, yeah.
That drawing was no... That was no Violet Monroe, okay?
Right. So, shout-outs to Violet.
Let's move on to our next celebrity ghost story. This is back in Los Angeles this time, and legendary comedic actor Fred Willard.
We had lived in Hollywood, and then we bought a house... a little further west in Brentwood, and my daughter was quite little, and we bought the house from Anne Francis, and she was the star of a movie called Forbidden Planet. When we bought the house, Anne Francis said, "Now I must tell you, we have a ghost in the house. She's a friendly ghost. She won't do you any harm." And I didn't believe in ghosts. I said, "Oh, well, that's interesting." We'd lived there about 6 weeks, and I'd forgotten the story entirely. We came home one night, and coincidentally, it was a very rainy night. It was in November, and I walked into the house, and I opened the door, and there was a rocking chair in front of our television set, and the rocking chair was rocking back and forth, and it kind of gave me a little goosebump.
Yeah, gave him a little goosebump.
Yeah, kind of.
This is... So what do you got? You guys like Fred Willard? Man, I love Fred Willard. Love him. That's yeah. show. He's just so like, great.
So charming.
Mighty
yeah.
Wind.
Yeah, it's just
one of the greatest to ever do it, man, for sure.
I love him. Moving Violations, weird little part he has now. But yeah, so he buys a house from the actress from Forbidden Planet. That was kind of interesting. That's the whole Hollywood thing, man. You get to see all these people are buying houses from other famous people. It's just this Hollywood cycle, and they all get these whole Hollywood ghosts they have to thing. So he's got a rocking chair moving around.
Ooh, real original.
He immediately reminded me of that new song WAP when he said, "There's a ghost in this house." I just kept hearing, "There's some ghosts in this house. There's some ghosts in this house."
I like how he sounded like himself when he's like, "Oh yeah, all right, that's really interesting. Whatever,
yeah,
I'll ghost him."
Very casual, of course.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, there's just something super charming about just his delivery and even just everyday conversation.
Yeah, so let's hear more. So this Fred Willard, he has more about this friendly rocking chair ghost.
I have a feeling that this ghost, when she lived there, that was her room where she would sit because there was a nice fireplace. There was the picture window with a little porch. So that was probably her comfortable room. Well, it was the den. So we'd sit there and we'd be watching television. And suddenly, not so much when my wife and I were watching it, but if our daughter was there, if something very violent would come on, it would suddenly turn off. And the first few times my wife said, "Well, there's your ghost," we just assumed that was it. After a while, I suddenly realized that there was a pattern. Even if it was a dramatic show, particularly if it was anything aimed at women getting beaten or killed, it would go off in the middle of the story. I don't know if she was watching it with us or she could tell that it was violence or news, particularly news of a very angry or violent story. Just go off.
What are they watching in the Willard house? So much, I've not seen a lot of violence against women on TV. I guess this was early. Maybe this was the 80s or 90s. But the ghost is turning off the TV when there's violence, especially against women.
Yeah, I've heard of something like that. I heard a story where it was the ghost of a little boy, but same thing. He didn't like violent shows or movies or scary shows. Anytime that things got like creepy or scary, like same thing. It would be turned off, and then the person would be like, okay, sorry, you know, I'll change it to something lighter. And no problem.
It's always up away with TV. I mean, I know it's a bit of a trope and it was in Poltergeist, but they do seem to have some kind of power over that.
Yeah.
Maybe that comes from somewhere, though. Maybe the Poltergeist trope comes from somewhere, you know?
Yeah. My TV used to turn off and on all the time in the house I grew up in. That was a common occurrence where we just got used to it. It'd be out of nowhere. It would just turn off and then on and...
Fred Willard just told Steven Spielberg all about it. And then the movie.
This sounds like a protective ghost, though. It sounds like it's trying to protect her rather than like the ghost that Drea just mentioned where it was a kid who like sounded like he would get scared and turn it off. This is more like just like don't
show
even,
your daughter. Why are they watching violent
Anytime
women? Stuff with their six-year-old daughter?
A woman gets dismembered or brutalized. You know, the normal things that are on TV or the news.
This ghost is just such a weakling. Can't even handle a little violence towards women.
I've been trying to watch Friday the 13th Part 2 for months, and he keeps turning it off, and I can't return it. I've never seen it.
Oh,
but
man.
I was not expecting this from Fred Willard. So let's hear more about this haunted TV.
Our daughter was very young at the time, and I noticed something else which always puzzled me. If she'd be watching television with us, if there was ever scenes of a terrible car accident, and the announcer was saying there was alcohol involved, the whole story would play through, and then the TV would go off.
Whoa.
I don't know if there was some communication with my daughter that she knew that this was a friendly ghost. She never got scared. She never said, this is very frightening. About 10 years later, we got another TV. The same thing happened with that. And it was very eerie. First 4 or 5 days, it would show the same accident. The car smashed up against a tree. The tree the next day, the picture of the, you know, friends in memory, and there'd be ribbons on the tree, flowers and teddy bears, the messages, "God bless you." That's the last image you'd see for a few seconds. And then it would just suddenly go black.
And God bless you indeed. This is 10 years. 10 years later, he finally gets a new TV after 10 years. Come on, Fred Willard. You want a lot of movies. Why are you waiting so long? Upgrade your tech. But he's seeing the same tree and accident being shown on his TV constantly. It's very, very
That's
weird.
That's really weird.
That's
very
crazy.
Strange.
I mean, It's very telling. I don't think that it was the TV. Did he say that it keeps happening when he got the new TV? Or
yeah, that's what he said. 10 years later. So the daughter is now 16 years old, and now it's still happening. New TV, same house, same rocking chair, doing its thing. But I had to add this. We got soundboard 3 because I had to get Fred Willard on the board. Of course, if he's saying this.
God bless you.
God bless you.
God bless you.
He's getting it out there with the God bless yous, you know?
He's in the list. Yeah, we've got about 10 God bless you indeeds on there. Fred Willard's in there, too. We'll put him in the list.
God bless you, Dr. Beeper.
So they soon find out what the friendly ghost was trying to warn the Willard family all about.
My daughter was 16. She had a lot of very responsible friends. And they'd all started driving. And they'd been at a party at a friend's house, and going to another friend's house, they were not drunk. They were all sober. And four of them got in a car. My daughter went in another car. And there's a big strip down San Vicente Boulevard leading down to Santa Monica. And they were going crossways. And were hit by a drunk driver. The car ended up smashed into a tree. And my daughter, I'd never seen her so upset. She was inconsolable. All her friends were killed.
Whoa.
Wow, that is so dark. I was not expecting this from a Fred Willard, a funny ghost story, but it seems that this thing was somehow trying to warn the daughter, and she heeded the warning, but her friends have all perished.
Yeah, I mean, what do you do with a warning like that, though? Like, you just never get in a car? Like,
yeah. Or did she choose, like, a different seat in the car? Like, if all of her friends, like, she just happened to be in the one seat where...
No, she didn't go. She declined them. He established they were all...
Oh, I missed that.
Her friends were all sober. They were just leaving the party.
She went in a different car. Yeah.
She said, no thanks. I'm not going to go with you guys because the TV does things. But I don't mean try to even make light of this.
She's
it's
like,
really,
ever since
really
I was
dark.
A kid, it's all led to this moment. I'm just feeling that now is the time I'm going to listen to this weird warning that I've been getting.
Celebrities have the best story. Dude, would you have expected this from Fred Willard? The amazing, unbelievable things are happening to our most famous funny bit man.
Yes and no.
I had to stop and rewind it at this point because I was kind of like sort of watching. I was watching it with it playing in the background sort of. And then this happened and I went, wait, what the hell just happened? And I paused it and rewound it and I was like, did I hear that right? Like, everybody died?
Yeah.
What, dude?
Yeah,
this is crazy.
Everybody died.
This is insane. This is insane.
Yeah.
Yeah, and let's hear the next clip because there's even more evidence that the spirit was trying to warn the daughter.
She wanted to drive by about a week later to the site where the car had hit the tree. And it was very eerie because there was a tree with a couple of ribbons and the flowers and the sign, God bless you, exactly. It makes me feel strange just to say it, but exactly the image we'd seen on television just before the picture had blacked out.
Everything is there. Dude. So the image they saw, that is the image of the memorial. Even the God bless you is there.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm a little bit confused by, because it sounded like it was the after image or that it was stuck on a frame of whatever program they were watching at the time, but it was a totally separate image. That was coming
some
on.
Kind of ghostly visual premonition on a television.
It was like a transmission from the future.
Yeah, yeah. And that's, I guess it's one of those things where if they're not able to adequately warn the person, like it was just pure happenstance that she didn't get into that car. But I guess maybe a communication saying like, hey, just,
I don't know, maybe the daughter just, it came over and everything hit her at once. It all led to this. Mm. So after this event, Fred went and visited the woman who sold them that house, and he told her about what happened.
And I said, well, I said, we have a ghost. That ghost is there. And I said, yeah, who was this woman? She's, well, I didn't know her, but she lived in the house, and she was killed in a terrible traffic accident. They took her to a hospital where she lived for about 2 or 3 days and she died in the hospital. So she never got back to see this house that she loved. And this ghost, I don't know, I'm putting two and two together. Maybe this was her mission now, that she would come back here and help out other people. She saw that we had this young daughter. I think she did become very protective.
Man, this woman dies, and now she's saving others from a similar fate.
It's touching, but it's just also so sad that that happened to her originally, and that well, it just sucks that her, that girl's friends died too. Like, that didn't even happen either. How come she couldn't protect them too?
The girl's family.
They didn't have a TV.
Yeah, what if they're watching? Yeah, no, they didn't have the. They didn't live in the cool Hollywood house. What if they're? Yeah, what if they're watching the show though, and they're like, "Wow, yeah, thanks, Fred Willard, for like rubbing it in." We, yeah.
Oh my god, I didn't even think about that. Yeah, that's gotta hurt.
Yeah, there's a little bit. There's a slight level of insensitivity to the way that it's the story's told, but it's,
oh, on this show, never. No, we are the most insensitive show there is.
It is pretty crazy though. That's actually nuts. That you know, she's a protective ghost, and she's. It's kind of like that's her duty now, is to like usher other spirits who are either usher other spirits who die in a similar way, or just to kind of be like the middleman between you know, our living world and the ghost world, and people who die in.
But you gotta live in that house. You gotta live in that house.
That's
that
the only way you can be
you.
Protected from car accidents. You have to live in that house.
That's crazy.
So now here's the epilogue from the Fred Willard.
About 10 years later, when we moved, we went back to get the chair and a few other things. We took it to our new house. It's never rocked. We took that same television to our new house, and it's never gone off when there's violence. We never put it in any words. It was kind of subliminal. Like, pay attention to this, making sure we got the certain lessons. It must have sunk in.
They coming?
I was thankful my daughter wasn't in that car. This ghost was there to warn her.
Yeah, see, it wasn't the TV or the chair. It's the house. Man, I would have never moved. I've just lived there forever. The ghost would just always let you know what's up.
Well, kind of, but that's what I mean. Like, you get these warnings and you don't know when this thing's going to happen. Like, it's just cool. Now I'm scared until the thing happens.
Yeah, it's like getting a dream. Like, I don't, what is this supposed to, is it supposed to help me? Am I supposed to figure out something from this?
Sometimes you get like a weird, stupid premonition, and then like, but there was no way to prevent the thing that happened. Like, okay, cool. What was that for? What was the good in that?
Wait 10 years, you'll figure it out.
Yeah, exactly. Bye.
God bless
TV.
You indeed.
One thing that you can say about this story is, like, why would he make this up? Like, why? I don't want to make a joke about it, but why would he lie about something like this?
Oh, why would I lie about something like that?
I did it.
Thank you.
Yeah, you did. Story. I mean, as positive as for him, it's definitely a celebrity ghost story, and that's what we've come to expect from these. So, now it's time for our final celebrity ghost story of the program. And this time, this is from one of my favorite actresses of all time, Carrie Fisher. She played Princess Leia in the Star Wars films. She was also a very talented writer. She worked on many, many great films. And she also has a ghost story. She lived in a very old Hollywood home, the kind that you would assume is haunted. The ship captain from King Kong, he used to own the house and he died there. Oh, there was a lot of history in this house, a history that would now be added upon.
A friend of mine named Greg Stevens, gay friend of mine, a Republican gay. I mean, the combination of what he was is a Republican gay drug addict, which is an unusual combination, I think. But he was a lot of fun. His family lived in L.A., but he was at odds with his family, so my house was his home. So what happened was Greg came out here for the Academy Awards exactly almost 4 years ago because he wanted to go to all the parties. He arrived on a Friday, went to a party with us. I went home earlier than he did. Then he came back afterwards, and he had brought with him his assistant friend, Judy. He slept with me because I wasn't going to sleep with Judy, and Judy slept in my guest room where he would normally sleep. So this was the first time he'd ever slept in my bed, and it was the last time he ever slept in my bed. I woke up, and then I went over and was banging on him. Greg died in my bed that night.
Man, poor Carrie. I cannot imagine a friend dying right next to you in bed. Man, that is devastating.
Oh, man. Yeah, geez.
It's the way that she describes him, though. Like, Carrie, like the cigarettes that she smoked, Carrie was unfiltered. She just said anything that came to her mind and just let it roll right off her tongue. The way she described him as a gay Republican drug addict. Just a great way Carrie to introduce somebody.
Carrie didn't judge. Carrie's like, oh, she's cool with everybody. Everyone's got a place. And this, yeah, he's a cool guy. You know, it didn't matter to her. But unfortunately, at this guy's death, she blamed herself because she even said herself that this was on her watch. That it happened in her bed. She had brought him out there to party.
Oh, and come on, Carrie.
This just happened. Yeah, I know. She took it hard. So not only does she have this grief and regret, she was about to have something else.
After a while in the house, there was this really strong sense of a presence in the house. It was like it was just heavier, just kind of, you know, there was something in the house. So that I would come home and say, hi, Greg, I'm back. I mean, it was just really odd. It was just this, like you'd walk in the air and there was something liquid about it almost. You know, like you were just moving through this aura or something. Very soon after that, noises. I mean, vivid noises.
Yeah, most of the ghosts we've heard tonight, these are total stranger ghosts, you know, talking to Joan Rivers and to Fred Willard. This is a lot more personal. This is someone that died in your bed and they are in your house.
Yeah, that's got to have some kind of remnant, some spiritual residue, if you will, as much as I hate that word. She described it as liquid. What else am I supposed to call it?
She could feel his aura. Ghost almost juice. Like he was like his presence, like wanted to be in her. I mean, not in like a possession way, but that she could feel his aura, his presence there. And she wasn't the only one to experience these noises. I'm glad she added this part because this is Carrie Fisher. And, you know, she was definitely a wild child and had a lot of fun in the time. And, but she has someone to back it up because the man that she was dating at the time, he also heard the noises. So it wasn't just in her head, but it would continue.
One night I was in my room, the room that Greg had died in. And it was very, very late at night. And I was writing. I had this gag toy. I had used it many years before when I was doing writing one of the young indies with George Lucas, and we both had them, and you'd push the button on it, and it would just say awful things to you.
You're an
asshole. Eat. Are you talking to me? And I'd left it in the room next to mine, my closet.
Okay, wait. I love this anecdote that it's her and George Lucas are playing with one of those dumb insult boxes that just like, kiss my butt, you're lame, blah, blah, blah. That this is what they're doing, working on young Indy. Play soundboard 4, because I had to add Princess Leia saying this.
Eat are you talking to me?
Dude, when she said I had this gag toy,
yeah,
I
was like, yeah.
Wait, yeah, what?
She meant a sex toy.
Yeah, exactly.
I feel like this whole episode, you, Jude, and I have just been on the same page.
We're not smutting this up.
Every reaction that we've had.
You press a button on it, it says, eat shit. You're like, ew, what the fuck is this toy?
I love that the thing just said all of her favorite phrases. Like everything she says anyway on the daily.
It's one of those keychains that you should buy. Kiss my butt, go to hell. Like one of those. And the image of her, George Lucas, oh, the maker of Star Wars, holding one of those, being
amazing.
Like, are you effing talking to me? Like, oh, great.
They both had one.
Drug addicts.
They had two of them while they were doing this, too, so they would have wars
against
each other.
Yeah, they would go back and forth.
Oh, yeah.
I really didn't like that second eat shit, Carrie. It's like, all right, shut up.
Eat sh- are you talking to me?
So why is she mentioning the eat shit toy? Well, this is why.
And through the wall, I heard, which really scared me. And I didn't want to go in there and look for the toy or, you know. I stayed in the room and I sort of calmed down and it happened again. And I was quite frightened by this, but I just... I knew it was Greg. Both times the little toy
said, "Are you talking to me?"
Yeah, he's talking through the toy. And this
talking
toy,
to me?
This toy is in a dresser where he would keep his clothes. And yeah, and then she would talk to him. You heard her. She was like, "Hey, Greg." She was talking to him. It wasn't telling her, "Kiss my butt" or "eat anything." It was just saying, are you, well, she cleaned it up. I think it said, "Are you effing talking to me?" If we play the sound back, I think that was the accurate thing.
"Eat are you talking to me?"
Yeah. She cleaned it up the second time. It is funny to think of a ghost messing with you like this, but it wasn't fun for Carrie Fisher.
I said, "Greg, stop it. That is not funny. Out of all the little things that it could have said, the one thing that the machine, the little toy had said was, basically, are you communicating with me?" My editor of my book, I told her about it, and she said, "Well, maybe I should talk to the psychic." This wasn't something I did commonly, but anyway, she put me in touch with this woman, and I talked to her. I was crying. Anyway, she said that he was pulled out of life so abruptly, and he was, you know, in his 40s, he was quite young, so that she felt that he was in distress partly. I mean, just that he did not accept leaving, and that part of him, yes, was in the house, and even part of him was trying to sort of enter me in a way, because sort of my distress was his, was a manifestation of his distress.
Man, and another psychic. I think Fred Willard, he's the only one who didn't employ either a witch or a voodoo priestess or a psychic. Yeah.
He probably should have. It would have helped explain what was going on with that news report and what the ghost was really trying to get across. He should have called a psychic. It would have helped.
Yeah, you have to reach out to somebody like when you're in a position like this where it's actually causing you distress or you're feeling, like she said, some kind of, it turned out to be a manifestation of that. Sometimes you do need help, and it's kind of impressive, not really impressive, it's surprising when people go through it without reaching out for help.
Man, if you ever see an auction for a Carrie Fisher joke insult box, we know that.
Oh,
the,
pick
the,
it up.
We know that. Yeah. God damn it. Zach Baggins, don't steal that. Don't steal that.
Oh, God. Oh, now that you've. Yeah. He's shit. Of course he's going to jump on it.
But at the same time, it makes me think that, like, you know, you can go out of your way to get psychics and to get voodoo priestesses. But then sometimes with, like, Joan, it's as simple as just taking a picture and hanging a picture on the wall to solve the situation, you know?
Mm-hmm. Follow your instincts.
Yeah, and I hope I don't die in some way where I'm, because it's a very traumatic death for Greg, and I don't want to die in some like traumatic way where I'm stuck
like in
here,
a hurricane.
Like Bruce Willis. Yeah, like Bruce Willis. Yeah, like I'm doing right now in Hurricane Mora.
Recording this God, that's show dark, Dred. Jeez,
hours away.
I hope he doesn't. I'm saying I hope he doesn't die.
This could be my final episode. We don't know.
Holy shit!
Literally, the bumper sticker right beside there. You. It says "We don't know" right behind your head. You're gonna be fine because you brought the wand with you, right? Oh wait, no, you didn't.
Oh shit, no,
I didn't.
He will be
reminded me of that too.
He'll be fine.
He'll be fine.
It's fine. It won't be. Yeah, because I'm well aware of what's happening. Not like Bruce Willis or Greg. But here is the conclusion to this Carrie Fisher ghost story.
Sort of a natural thing that he wouldn't want to leave because he was planning on being settled there, and so in a way, he did settle there for a while after he died. I didn't think it was a bad thing. Like it wasn't like I would come and. have an exorcist or something come and make him get out. It was completely okay with me. I think it makes sense to stay around where you're comfortable, stay around those that you love until, you know, you can accept things and move on.
Yeah, I'm glad that Greg does seem to be at peace. He's at a place he wanted to be, and at least Carrie Fisher's not getting woken up at 4 a.m. like Joan Rivers either.
With pornographic images on her walls. Yeah, no, I mean, that does kind of speak to that she must have had a really, really cool house.
Oh, you know, for sure. Living at Carrie Fisher's house.
He's like, well, I'm not ready to leave here yet. I'm supposed to be here for a minute.
It's such a sweet sentiment, too. Like, that's such a hard, you know, like, if it's your friend, you know, you don't want to kick him out. It's like,
of course not.
That's such a tough thing, you know? You wouldn't want to get rid of them, but you also want them to be at peace. So I feel like that's really a tough situation to be in for her.
I think it's as simple as just saying, like, stay here as long as you want, as long as you need to. You're welcome here. Just don't wake me up at 3 or 4 a.m. We're going to be cool. It's like a roommate's thing, you know? Take your time.
Yeah, it's very respectful of her.
Yeah.
Leave the gag thing alone.
No, we want that. We need that. Yeah, stop playing kiss my butt at 4 a.m.
See, I would actually welcome that. I'd be like, that's funny.
Actually, yeah,
that,
honestly,
Greg.
If it was my friend, I'd be like, yeah, okay. Like, I will kiss your butt. Oh,
that's just the kind of friend that Jude is.
Eat Are you talking to me?
Are you?
Oh, man, I love it so much. Guys, please use that. I hear Carrie Fish all the time. Do you guys got any final thoughts on these celebrity ghost stories? What about you, Jude?
I don't think so. Other than you found some really great ghost stories, especially that Fred Willard one where he's like, eh, I got a ghost.
Yeah, we got it. Yeah. I enjoyed all of them. What about you?
Yeah, they were really good.
Oh, man. Each one of these, they got better and better. Because I will say, yeah, the Regis Philbin one was really funny. But the others, they just...
I'm a Marine!
But, I mean, they just got more and more, like, poignant and, like, sentimental. Like, I was getting emotional at certain points listening to them. And it's nice to know that celebrities are people like us, too, who get haunted. But these ones in particular seem to be very, like, sweet stories.
They've all been helped in some way in their life, in their career. It seems these all seem very positive. All right, what about you, Rob? You got any final thoughts on these celebrity ghost stories?
Not really. I think Jude summed it up pretty well. It was very interesting hearing these stories, and I especially like the Carrie story. I think it was really cool hearing that sort of perspective of losing a friend and wanting to just keep them around. I think that's a really cool thing. But all the stories, very interesting.
Yeah, she had a really unique perspective, and I liked all of these. We might have to revisit this show sometime, but definitely not the... I found out there's also a British version of this show, and it should not be called Celebrity Ghost Stories, unless you're in, I guess, maybe people in England know who these people are. I looked at Liz, I didn't know who anybody was. So I'll stick to the American version for my celebrities.
They're
they
all
don't have
football
to be celebrities,
players.
They're just still guys.
All soccer guys.
All footballers.
Even the American version, there's a few episodes where if you look at the list of everybody that's in it, I don't recognize any of the names of the people in a full episode. So it's like, how much of a celebrity are they? It's like,
oh,
but celebrity.
Are you really watching it for the celebrity factor? I'm watching it for a good ghost story.
No,
a little bit of both.
They had some loaded episodes. I think Carrie Fisher and John Waters were on the same episode.
Well, damn.
So, John Waters. Yeah,
I'm missing the loaded ones.
We'll do these again. But before we go, I just want to say, coming off that last clip, RIP Carrie Fisher. And RIP Regis Philbin. And RIP Joan Rivers and RIP Fred Willard. They are all missed, and these were dead celebrity ghost stories.
God
They're
damn
all...
it, Russ.
Yes.
You could have started with that. Jeez.
Well, I put that together about halfway through watching this. I was like, wait a second. Is that why they call this celebrity ghost stories? Because these people are all ghosts now? Or, like,
what's cool is, like, maybe
what are the chances? Interviews.
Yeah. Well, this might instigate some hauntings on our end now that we've been talking about them.
I don't know. So. And I look, a lot of people in this show have passed on. Maybe there is a celebrity ghost stories curse, and that's what's taking people out. Oh. But
dude, you're right. There is an insane amount of people that are on this show. Like, half of the people that have appeared on this show are now not alive, pretty much.
Yeah. I turned out a lot of stories, like Jerry Stiller and Roddy Piper. There were a lot of other passed on celebrities, but they have a lot of dad issues and friend issues, and it was too sad to be on the show. But go to Unbelievers Podcast. Go to UnbelieversPodcast.com. Go answer this week's poll. What's the best ghost story? Joan Rivers, Regis, Fred Willard, Carrie Fisher. And that's it. Let's get out now for dead celebrity ghost stories. And some of these ran Regis and Fred Willard, very recent book that have passed on. Joan Rivers and Carrie have been gone for a while. But Jude, I want to mention, maybe my thing has been a little messed up. There's some theories about Joan Rivers, isn't there?
Yeah, I was going to bring this up initially, and I was like, you know, do we really...
this isn't the time. No, it is now.
Is this the time? I don't know.
This is the time.
It's Joan o'clock.
I asked before, and Russ said, like, yeah, I think I've heard a thing or two, so... I mean, this is just off the top of my head. Like, I didn't look into it anymore of it. But so she's like walking down the street in New York, and there's some paparazzi coming up to her, and they're like, "Hey, do you think that we'll ever have a gay president?" And she's like, "We already have it with Obama." And, like, and the reporter's like,
"Now, this is Joan Rivers, like, we're talking about. Joan Rivers. This. Yes.
She says it into the camera, and then she's walking into her house, probably the ballroom house, and then he has like, "Wait, what?" And she's like, "Michelle Obama is a transgender. We all know it."
Yes.
And then she, so then she goes in like a month later for some like surgery.
Plastic surgery. She does the surgery and she never wakes up. She passes away during the plastic surgery. So the theory, there is a conspiracy theory that Joan Rivers was killed because of that, but that it's also a theory that she wasn't killed. She was instead disappeared. And there is a weird, weird video out there of a woman who looks a lot like a not dolled up current age Joan Rivers, with just looking like a regular old lady. And they match up the face and they're like, "This is straight up Joan Rivers." And it's really strange. It actually could be her. And it's all because she called – it's according to this conspiracy, all because she called Michelle Obama a man. And it's a very, very strange world. That's right, Jude?
Yeah. Very strange.
This is the first I'm hearing of this theory.
It was probably the first a lot happened.
Exactly. That's what
I knew that she. I knew there was some sort of. I knew there was some sort of controversy around her that she had been like semi canceled before she passed away, but I wasn't sure what it. Why it was.
This is why.
And
this is
I understand. That's kind of a dumb thing to say. That's a very very dumb thing to say.
Like such an edgy kind of person that you'd be like.
She should have something better. Something better than that. You know what I mean?
Well, hey, in her old age, she was losing. You know,
she could tell a hell of a joke. That is
you're supposed to think that the murdering deep state is like Star Wars, but it's Joan Rivers. We'll just let her disappear and go live out her life. No, it's. But I said it's just a conspiracy, and it's just a weird one. And thank you for bringing it up. But I will say, R.I.P. Joan Rivers. I don't really think that's her. So let's get into the Unbelievers mailbag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time.
Woo!
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 Yeah, back to a traditional Unbelievers mailbag. So we got a very interesting email in response to last week's episode, UFO Europe. So I'm just going to read it because it is just titled Podcast and screaming at us. And the entire email is in Romanian. So shout out to our Romanian listeners. And thank you for having to make us translate this. I'm going to read the Romanian.
And for having access to the internet. That's a big, big thing.
Yeah, good.
Yeah. They looked to the sky at the right time. And they got it. And their mail came through. We're going to read it. We translated it. And this is from Romania. It says, "Dear Ryan Russell, I am delighted to see my country, beautiful Romania, after all, presented, for example, a podcast." Okay. I think something's lost in the translation a little bit. But here we go.
Okay, Ryan.
"However, I like the presentation that despises the glorious country of Romania because I threw away and filled my pants. Is it a legitimate program? Your podcast.
Is it a legitimate program?
Your podcast tried to introduce my long news story that I fought. Although I appreciate the coverage of the events of the unidentified flying saucer, I remind you that Romania is modern and progressive in our American country." Wait, what do you mean? I don't know what that means.
Is this an American territory now?
I don't know. In the same way, we have complete internet for 16 hours a day. Okay, weird brag. The Romanian television service, just to add a 10-read channel, our cable service. Wow, they got 10 channels there. All right, wasn't the sky. I was wrong. You have 10 channels. You have 16 hours of internet. And it goes on and says, "This goal is remarkable. Your attitude is rude, and you will leave my aunt in Rasnov, and the vampire witches from the darkest black forest will surely call to haunt you on your terrible podcast. Come to Romania and say such things, and you will surely be met by a strong man like an ox who will snatch your police pants." Interrupt. Signed, Andre. God really bless you. Okay, thank you so much. Oh,
interrupt.
Andre, really, or in a separate translation I've seen is Andrew. I think this is Andrew or Andre from Romania. Thank you so much.
Oh my God. Interrupt is probably discontinue, I think, yeah. Right?
Interrupt must be discontinue. That's probably what it is.
Is this a legitimate
program? There's so much gold in that email. I love
my
it so much.
So bad right
I love Romania.
Oh, this is the best thing ever.
Oh my
Romania,
God.
Romania, you guys get it. We were just having a goof on you. We're just having a laugh. We love you guys. Thank you for chiming in. And hopefully you're hearing this in one of the 16
on
hours 16 where
hours.
Your internet works.
The goal of your program was
remarkable.
Mean or something.
Oh my gosh. It was rude. We were rude.
But he liked it. He said it. What did he say?
There was some things lost in translation there. I think generally
everything was lost in translation. That's why it's so good.
But we found it, and I'm so glad we did. That was fantastic.
Oh my God.
He seems cool with us, though, and I think he appreciates the coverage. That's all I want to do, and give Romania a little coverage. There was like other podcasts talking about Romania. So,
love you, Romania.
Yeah. Thanks. Shout out to Romania. And that's it. And we have a few voicemails. We're not going to play in this week. Send us some more voicemails. We're going to do a great voicemail segment next week. Got a couple in there. We need a few more. And that's it for this week's Unbelievers Mailbag.
The Unbelievers Mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbag.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time. Woo!
All right, we're getting close to the end, but we got one more segment. It's everyone's third favorite segment, poll results. This week's poll, what's the strangest thing in Europe? And the choices were UFO balls, angel hair, aurora borealis, K-Mill, or other. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, what do you think the unbelievers said?
Oh, man. Angel hair on K-Mill. Angel hair.
All right. What about you, Jude?
Damn it. I was going to say angel hair because of that weird Spider-Man
no, that's good.
Shit
I
that
usually
was out
win.
There.
No, I'm kidding.
All right. What about you, Rob Okey?
I'm going to say K-Mill because I love him, but he's weird. He's a weird guy. But I still love him, though.
Now, correct. Congratulations, Rob Okey, with 5.26 of the vote. K-Mill
yes!
is the strangest thing in Europe.
I don't think I've ever won. That's amazing.
There you go, Rob. You got it this time. And, of course, there are others. What's the strangest thing in Europe? The Queen. Heard she collects children. Signed, outlaw. Okay.
True
yeah,
story.
You're probably on with something there.
Oh,
what's the strangest thing in Europe? Steamed hams. Psych, pants filler. There you go. There you go,
nice.
Pants filler.
Just means Russ's
really
day
it.
Right now.
You got it.
Be throwing up and filling my pants.
Awesome one, pants filler. What's the strangest thing in Europe? I think they eat cats. Signed, Yankee boy cock lover. Oh, boy.
Hell yeah.
Got a couple things in there. I don't know about the cock lover.
I think it ate my cat.
Yes, thank you so much, because I guess this guy likes to say, oh, hey.
Hey, Yankee boys, do you need some help? I'll give you a hand. I can fix your craft.
I can fix your cock.
All right, thank you, Yankee boy cock lover. What's the strangest thing in Europe? The toilet squirt water up your poop hole, bro. Alarming at first, but you start to look forward to it after a while. Okay, yeah. Signed, and bro down on me. Thank you, bro down on me. You're right. I've
been. Great description of bidet.
Yeah. Shout out to bidets. Shout out to bidets out there. Hell yeah.
It's the strangest thing in Europe. What is the strangest thing in Europe? It's when I was on an all-fruit diet. The diarrhea was insane. Signed, Rococo style. And hey, Rococo style, I've been seeing you signing off. I went and found the clip. Here it is, just for you, Rococo style.
Of the Rococo style that embellished the building.
Yeah, I told you, it's coming back.
What about being on an all-fruit diet?
All-fruit diet.
I was on a...
Look, the clips from the end of Unbelievers Podcast are unbelievable podcasts are hard to find. I had to go clip that myself.
They're
so
very
there you
hard
go, Rococo.
Yeah, no fruit diet for you right now, but maybe later.
We're trying to get the diarrhea away from here. What's the strangest thing in Europe? I don't know. K-Mill scholarly knowledge of dogging folklore. I love you, buddy, but stay out of the woods. Side the machinist. Yeah, you're right. K-Mill is always bringing up that dogging.
I don't know.
Is there anything
just like
that?
They described in the folklore?
There it is. Here's his folklore.
Nice.
What's the strangest thing in Europe? Manny's on French fries. Barf. Signed. Signed corrupted mask. I think we got something for barf, huh?
Be throwing up and filling my pants.
All right, that's close enough to barf. Go on, corrupted mask.
That's true.
What's the strangest thing in Europe? All those uncut rods. It's like a gray on the roof wearing a hoodie. Oh, no.
Hey, man, that's natural.
Wait, who said that one?
Signed, Friendly Weatherman. Yeah. Thank you, Friendly Weatherman.
That wasn't very
all those
friendly.
Uncut rods, it's just like...
A gray on the roof, observing.
Wearing a hoodie. Thank you so much.
In 1999, those rods are huge, man.
All right, they don't have to be huge for this one. I know. But thank
you
so much.
And he's a weatherman,
much.
Right?
Don't be afraid. I'm not going to hurt you. I'm the weatherman.
All right. Thank you. I love you, Friendly Weatherman. What's the strangest thing in Europe? Is this a real show? Signed, Nick Kalibak. I don't know, Nick. We're questioning that ourselves. But
is this a legitimate program?
Yeah.
Is this a legitimate program?
Is this a real show?
I think that sign-off is Nick Kalibak. So if you read it...
Kalibak. All right, Kalibak. I'm thinking of the DC villain Kalibak, the assistant to Darkseid. What's the strangest thing in Europe? Almost no one has accepted this UFO ball story of mine.
I miss this song.
Sign Green Finhawk. Oh, there's something there. What are those balls like, Rob?
Almost nobody has accepted this apple story of mine.
Oh, yeah, that was the apples. I'm sorry. I was thinking of...
Smaller balls rolled towards him.
Okay. Thank you, Green Finhawk. That's a great one. What's the strangest thing in Europe? UFOs teabagging a Scotsman. Guys, this might be peak Unbelievers. Okay? 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 Okay. Signed. And you're right. Signed, Blue Box UFO. Yeah, that UFO balls teabagging Scotsman. Great work. What do you think, Rob?
Okay.
Oh, God. So uncomfortable.
That was a really good one. That was a really good one. Thank you so much, Blue Box UFO. What's the strangest thing in Europe? Anything in Romania, or as they call it in folklore, the Vampire Bone Zone. Signed, signed the Wombat Preservationist. Yes, Romanian, the folklore is called the Vampire. Wait, what?
Want a great deal on a pre-owned vehicle?
Then get to Don Bone Ford, Don Bone Buick GMC, Bone Hyundai, and Bone Brothers Toyota today.
In the Bone Zone.
We really got to trim that down to where they just say the Bone Zone. All right.
I like to
know
where
maybe
it's
if
at.
You see that, if you see that Bone Zone, you might say,
"Oh no, vampire rod!"
Okay,
oh, no.
Thank you for the reservationist. What's the strangest thing in Europe? The odd overuse of the word trousers. Sounds like fishing sneakers. Signed, Jackass Squatch. Oh, thank you, Jackass Squatch. Oh God, do we really have to trio the trousers bit?
Trousers.
The trousers stand side of these trousers. Now, these police issue trousers stand side of the trousers. It's in these trousers to Robert Taylor's trousers upwards.
The trousers.
Oh, God. I forgot how long that clip is.
Yeah, it's a super cut thing. I don't know how this is happening, but let's keep it clean because to him it sounds like he's got.
Brought some new fishing sneakers.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Jackass Squatch. What's the strangest thing in Europe? Ever see anyone slap their ass cheeks together? What happened? Signed, Unbeliever Carol. I love Unbeliever Carol.
How do I always know it's her?
Because she's always.
Now she's always talking about slapping cheeks. She loves slapping cheeks nowadays. Because, you know.
Cheeks.
Where his ass stuck out? I seen his ass.
Yeah, they clap together. And then she just says,
What happened?
That's a deep cut. We don't even remember that one. You've done it a few times. We're always
if
baffled.
That was on what the soundboard game, I would lose.
That's from Winged Weirdies, the Winged Weirdies.
Yes, it is Winged Weirdies.
What happened?
Look, if it's on Carol's radar and it's on ours, great one. What's the strangest thing in Europe? In Europe, there was this bowl. It was supposed to ejaculate into the bowl, signed Harley Warren. He's back to it. Even after winning with it, he's not ditching the bit. Let's hear it.
We went to this room. There was this bowl on this table, and I was supposed to ejaculate into the bowl.
All right, thank you. We get it again, Harley Warren. What's the strangest thing in Europe? The idea of ball rods going after my torn trousers makes me fill my pants. Signed, left-handed buckle grabber. So many in there. Please don't play the trousers again, but give him a few of them. There's a few there.
Hey, there's rods on your tape.
Yes, of course, and I guess it's making
me... Be throwing
you...
up and filling my pants.
Man, people love that Upball Results. Thank you so much to the left-handed guy who's doing what?
I remember gripping my belt buckle with my left hand, I think it was.
Gripping?
Yeah, he was gripping it hard. What's the strangest thing in Europe? The underground tunnel, signed Mothman Mother. All right, oh, underground tunnels in Europe. That is actually very weird. Thank you, Mothman Mother. And finally, the final one for the night. What's the strangest thing in Europe? My DNA was found all over the corpse of a Victoria's Secret model. Signed Voodoo. Whoa, I don't even know. Is that clip even findable? What do you think, Rob?
No, it is not.
Okay, we don't have the Ivan Teller clip. I don't know why, but I will say this. Thank you very much. That was the final one. Thank you so much, Voodoo. Ivan Teller is once again on our radar. There might be some Ivan Teller content coming from us. I'm lifting the embargo on that. But boy, so many good ones for tonight. Let's hear some of a few. We had The Queen. She collects children from Outlaw. We had Pants Filler with Steamed Hams. Love it. We had Yankee Boy Cock Lover with I Think They Eat Cats. We had a Bro Down on Me with The Toilet Squirts Water Up Your Poop Hole, Bro. Alarming at first, but look forward to it. We had Rococo Style with It's When I Was on the All Fruit Diet. The diarrhea was insane. Oh, we had Machinist with, I don't know, Chemo Scholarly Knowledge of Dogging, Folklore, I Love You Buddy, Stay Out of the Woods. Corrupted Mask with Mayonnaise on French Fries, Barf. We had Friendly Weatherman with All Those Uncut Rods. It's like a gray on the roof wearing a hoodie. Oh, come on. We had Nick Kaleback with Is This a Real Show? We had Green Finhawk with Almost No One Has Accepted This UFO Ball Story of Mine. That's a really good one. We had Blue Box UFO with UFOs Teabagging a Scotsman. Guys, this may be peak Unbelievers. Okay. That was really good. Wombat Preservations with Anything in Romania as the Call in Folklore, the Vampire Bone Zone. We had Jack Asquatch with The Odd Overuse of Trousers. Sounds like fishing sneakers. We had Unbeliever Carol with Ever See Anyone Slap Their Ass Cheeks Together? Well, what happened? Harley Warren, Bull. We had Left-Handed Buckle Grabber with The Idea of Ball Rods Going After My Torn Trousers, Making Me Fill My Pants. Mothman Mother, The Underground Tunnels. And Voodooed with My DNA Was Found All Over the Corpse of a Victoria's Secret Model. This week, I'm leaving it up to the three of you to decide amongst yourself. Get a consensus. You guys talk. Who's going to win this week? Let's hear it. And if you guys can't decide, I will. Who do you want, Jude?
Okay, all right. I was just going to bust in because I've got one that's near and dear to my heart.
What is it, Jude? Who is it?
Friendly Weatherman. The Uncut Rods.
You know what? That was going to be mine also. I was going to say, I thought that was really funny because it took me a minute to figure out what he was talking about. And then when it clicked, I said, like, oh,
I love it.
That's
how did
funny.
It take you that long to figure out what
I'm
anyway.
Not very smart.
All right, Drea, you're the only one left. Who are you going to go with or what?
No, I like the bidet one by Bro Down on Me. After a while, you start to look forward to it.
All right. Well, congratulations. I'll throw in my vote. Friendly Weatherman.
Okay.
All those uncut rods, it's like a gray on the roof wearing a hoodie. Congratulations. Congratulations, Friendly Weatherman. You just won this week's poll results. All right, we come to the end of the program. Before we go, Drea Mora, do you have anything you would like to say or plug?
You can follow me on Instagram at @bestdreamora and on at Spirits and Spirits Pod for my other podcast that I'm doing. And we're also on Twitter at Ghost Drinkers.
Yes, check out Spirits and Spirits. What about you, Jude Prestia?
I am currently unemployed. You can follow me on Twitter at Judicial Review, the best handle of all time.
Please and do.
Brianna and I are about to adopt another puppy. Well, he's about a year and a half old. We're adopting him to keep Fox pepped up and to play with the two cats.
Get Fox
and stuff.
A buddy. And yeah, exactly. You did this on National Doggo Adopt Day, and I have a lot of respect for that.
What kind of dog is it? Is it possibly
bear dog, hog dog?
It's got to be one or the other.
Hog dog,
bear hog dog.
I think it was more of a ho dog. What about you, Rob Okey? You have anything you want to say or plug?
Check out my social medias at Rob Okey on everything, at Okey Audio if you'd like to start your own podcast. Check out our Twitch, twitch.tv/theunbelieverspodcast. We weren't on last week, but we're coming back this week with something fun. So check that out Friday night. And check out our Discord. All the links are in the description of this episode, so check that out.
Yeah, a lot going on in the Discord. A lot of good chatter. If you want to hang out with some unbelievers, Discord's a great place to be. And I'll just say, yeah, check out the live stream on Twitch on Friday night. If you see me there, I've somehow survived this hurricane, which is about 2 hours away. We're recording this on Wednesday night. Oh, we've got a Category 5 hurricane coming right up my pooper or whatever they were saying earlier.
Your bidet.
So, if this is the last episode, I am going to be really pissed at myself that it was this dumb, fluffy celebrity thing.
Oh, please. This
is
all
about dead celebrities,
on.
Russ.
We'll miss you, Russ.
It puts you in the pantheon.
Rest I almost peace. Forgot, too, that Tom Reed episode just dropped. Ghost Hunting in New England. Everybody go check that out.
Yeah, go check that out. The Unbelievers podcast hosts today were Drea Mora, Jude Prestia, and me, Rus Ryan. Our producer and soundboard engineer is Rob Okey. You can join our Patreon by going to patreon.com/unbelieverspodcast. You can follow us on Twitter at UnbelieversPod and Instagram at UnbelieversPodcast. Our Facebook group is the Unbelievable Podcast Network. Check out our merch store at cafepress.com/UnbelieversPodcast. And thank you so much to our patrons, Pamsy, JT Sprankles, Vic Voss, Robert Groom, Little BB, Dr. Ortega, Tyler Ventura, Adam Dvorak, Corrupted Mask, Michael Phillips, Weary Exile, Carol Valley, Manny MQ Ultra, CJP, Braden Hit, Raymond Royal, Todd X, Christopher Panici, The Moon, The Judgy Moon, Mike Henry, Bryce Kronenberger, Durgenberger Jr., Dawn Bright, Shannon Ferrigno, Tom O'Connell, Mark Braun, Donna Bance, Jenna Stevens, Cat Chaos, and they're Jason Kelly, Mike, Brian Ashton, Michael Armenta, Jackass, Wombat Preservationist, our fiscal poser and theme song creator is Unbeliever Aaron, a.k.a. Aaron Shilb. Go check out his new song on Spotify, Millennials. It's playing over the credits now. You're going to hear it at the end. Go support Aaron. He's got a new song, and he really wants people to go download it. Our official graphic designer and card maker who designed our logo is Raymond Orwell. Check out his work at PRavenCreative on Twitter and ProjectRavenCreative on Instagram. Our official Hawaii Bigfoot hunter is Jeremy Pascal. Our official resident Sagittarius is Kozanton. Our official madman is Unbeliever Adam. Our official Mothman enthusiast is Michael Shields. Our official MUFON inside man is Christa Moraes. Our official Unbeliever peacefully eating a hamburger is Michelle Durham. Our official Unbelievers time traveler is Taylor Nelson. Our official ghost hunter is Amelia Childs of Ghost Hunting in New England with Tom Reed. Our official senior European correspondent is Kay Mill of the I Don't Know podcast. Our official guardian of the bench is that Kraken Stacker. Our official alien bopper is No Chuck Bob, and this week's Unbeliever Focus is Unbeliever Bear, who happened to be in front of me at Popeye's recently. I asked him if Bear Grylls shits in the woods, and it was a bad idea because he must not have recognized me with the mask on because I had to wear the mask, because all he said was,
"Eat shit. Are you talking to me?"
All right, good night. Let's talk.
I know I can't be the only one who thinks millennials are dumb. Now I know what you're thinking. Hey, who is this little prick? And what gives him the right to sit and act like such a word omission? Let me tell you something, folks, something about me. My parents had an accident in 1993.
It's me.
'Cause I know I can't be the only one who sucks, who thinks my generation ruins everything we touch. But here's to hoping that you don't care too much. I know I can't be the only one who thinks millennials are dumb. Now I know I'm not the only one, because I know that I'm just dumb.
Discontinue! Discontinue!